Good morning, everybody. We are happy to see you here today. We are honored by so many guests. A lot of our own people are in various places honoring mothers, and we understand that. But your coming has really filled in the gap for us, and we thank you so much for being here. If I haven't met you yet, I want to, and I know everybody else here feels the same way. Hang around a little while and let us get to know you if we haven't met you yet, because we want to say thank you for coming. We hope you'll enjoy, and we always invite you to be with us anytime that you are able to come. Today's a special day. We say, well, every Lord's Day is special, and it is, and it should be. But on this day, we honor mothers. Now, we don't worship mothers, but we do highly respect and honor them. And, you know, it's part of God's eternal plan. You think about it, God could have brought us into the world in any number of ways that perhaps we couldn't imagine. But he chose to have mothers for every child born. He even honored motherhood by letting Jesus be born of a human mother. What an honor. No wonder the angel said that she was of all women most to be blessed. But a blessing to every woman who gets to be a mother. There are some who would love to be and cannot be. I always feel awkward on this day when we honor mothers, because there are those Christian ladies, children of God in the assembly, who don't get to share that. And we don't mean to overlook you at all, because we know you are equally servants of the Lord and would, in many cases, love to have had children of your own. There was a woman in the Old Testament who was unable to have a child of her own. Her name was Hannah. 1 Samuel talks about that, and we're going to focus largely on the incident that occurred in regard to her life and God giving her a child. And then we're going to talk about the things that we can learn from that mother and what she did. It's appropriate that we honor our mothers. I had the privilege of knowing my great-grandmother on the maternal side, and my grandmother, my mother, on dad's side. I knew my grandmother, and of course, that was as far back as it went on that side. On the paternal side, almost all my life, on yesterday, the Saturday before Mother's Day, I would find myself standing at the graves of those mothers who'd gone before. The great-grandmother, and then my granny that I knew for many years of my life. Finally, my own mother, and now one sister who was a mother. I always would go back to Oakland Cemetery, Van Zandt County, Texas, where from a little boy, I remember going every Saturday before Mother's Day to share a decoration day at that cemetery. And so I've driven great distances on Saturday afternoons and evenings to get back to where I preached. But I decided not to go yesterday, but I miss not having been there. We miss our mothers when they're gone. I would urge, before I forget, those of you who still have your mothers and grandmothers, do not take that for granted. Do not take for granted that they are here yet and you have the opportunity to say, we love you, and do things that will communicate to them that they are very, very special in your lives because of what they have done. There was a person, Margaret Widmer, who wrote a poem. I'll try to recite it. She said, she always leaned as she watched for us, anxious if we were late. In winter, by the window, in summer, at the gate. We teased her some, she who had such anxious care, but the way home always seemed safer and shorter because we knew that she would be waiting there. She never could forget us. She did always care. And so we were always on her mind, and she kept leaning as she waited there. And so now I believe that where she is, she must be waiting yet, anxious for us to come home, anxious if any of us are late, leaning by the heaven's window, waiting by heaven's gate. Motherhood has so many attachments. It has so many things that those of us who cannot and have not been mothers cannot fully appreciate. But I thought maybe I'd share this one thing that I read it to you, about the question of our lesson today. What is a mother to do? How does a mother serve? How does she cope with so many of the things, the anxieties, the stresses, the responsibilities, the cares, the difficulties that exist in a culture like we live in today? I saw this thing that said that a father and four children brought home a puppy, and they were discussing what they would name that new puppy. And the mother said, maybe you should name it Mother, because if it stays, I'm gone. One more thing for which to be responsible. But here's the big thing. Just as an illustration that we don't really understand, it's how to make a cake if you are a mother. Light the oven, get out the utensils and ingredients, remove the blocks and the toys from the oven, grease the pan, crack some nuts, measure 2 cups of flour, remove Johnny's hand from the flour, wash the flour off Johnny, remeasure the flour, put the flour and the baking powder and the salt in the sifter, get the dustpan and brush out the pieces of the bowl that Johnny just broke. Get another bowl. Answer the doorbell. Return to the kitchen. Remove Johnny's hands from the bowl. Wash Johnny's hands. Answer the phone. Return. Remove 1/4 of an inch of salt from the greased pan. Look for Johnny. Grease another pan. Answer the telephone. Return to the kitchen. Find Johnny. Remove his hands from the bowl. Pick up the greased pan and find nutshells in it. Head for Johnny, who flees, breaking another bowl. Wash the kitchen floor and the table and the wall and the dishes. Call the bakery. Take a nap. I think so many have been there, done that, because with children, things are so unpredictable, except they are predictable. And there are those who say, boy, I just can't wait till they're out of the house, and they will not provide any trouble after that. Little do we know. I know as a father, and I feel confident that it's also true for mothers, that our care and our responsibility and our involvement in the lives of our children never ceases. While some of the things that we may allude to today in connection with Hannah and her son seem to be just for those who are now in the child-rearing age and stage, those of us who are grandparents know that we're still involved. And the grandmothers know we still are needed and we still are apart. We're never separated. We wish they always would be safe. We wish we always could do everything they may need and everything that would protect them from the crime and from the lewdness, from the rudeness and the danger that exists in the culture in which we live. But we cannot put them in a bubble. We cannot make them Teflon. We cannot in any way do anything but really let them live. And so, as we must realize our limitations, there are some things that a mother can do. And I hasten to add that mother needs dad to help her with that. And I apologize even for that statement, because I know that so many mothers today don't have the dad. And so many homes are not full. And so when we talk about an ideal world, we have to realize that's what we're talking about. But we don't live in an ideal world. And things are not always as they seem, and they're not always as they should be. But we, being human creatures, understanding that, will make the most of the circumstance and seek as best we can to be the kind of people doing the kinds of things that God wants us to do in order that His work, His will, His church may continue to abide and to live and to do well upon this earth. What is a mother to do? I suggest that number one, in the case of Hannah, we have the example, you should give your child away. You say that sounds terribly difficult. That sounds like something I would never do and I should never be encouraged to do. But when we look at Hannah's situation, who had no child, there was another wife involved in that marriage. And that wife was having children. You can read it for yourself, 1 Samuel chapter 1, 2, and some into chapter 3. So that mother, that wife who was having children, was honored in ways that Hannah could not be. She was terribly distressed. Her husband was a good spiritual man who went up to worship every year. And he gave portions to both his wives that they might be able to contribute. And on this one time, Hannah went and she just went in to pray. She prayed silently, her mouth moving, but her heart pouring out to the Lord in an inaudible way. And she was asking God, give me a son. She did not ask just for a child. She asked for a son. And she did not just ask for a son for herself, for her pleasure, for her ability to have perhaps some equality with the other wife. She said, Lord, if you'll give me a son, I'll give him to you all the days of his life. Eli was standing close by, and Eli saw her lips moving, and he accused her of being drunken and asked, how long will you continue in this way? She said, sir, I'm not what you think. I'm praying. I'm praying to God to help me in my need. She did not explain to him what she'd asked for. He must have been embarrassed. We often are when we jump to conclusions about people's intent, their purpose and what they're doing. And so he said, you go and may God grant what you've asked. And in the proper time, God did grant. And there was that child, Samuel, which means he's been given to me by the Lord. She gave credit to him. The next year after that birth, when her husband went up to worship, she said, no, I'll not go. Not until the boy is old enough to be weaned. And when I go, I'll leave him. The commentaries say it was common for children in that age to not be weaned until they were about 2 to 3 years old, in some cases 4. But whenever it was time and he was weaned, she went up, and that time she left her son with Eli. And he served the Lord all his life. God called him to a very, very special calling. He, in fact, was the last of the judges and the first of the prophets. He was a pivotal point in all of the history of the development of God's relationship to the Jews in preparation for the birth of Jesus and the coming of the plan of salvation that God has for us still today. And who would know that that all started in the heart of a woman who wanted to be a mother and who prayed for a son, but who said to God, "If you give me a son, I'll give him back." I would urge those who are yet unmarried, or those who do not have children or may have more children, think seriously about the issue of a session with God where you do promise God, "I'll give my children to you. I will point them to you." There's a serious responsibility, because while we love these children, and physically we would protect them with everything we have, we are willing to sacrifice. We do things we wouldn't have believed we'd ever do when it comes to our grandchildren and even to our own children. But of all the things that we can do for them, the one that's more important than anything else, more important than housing, more important than food, shelter, more important than an education, more important than a college education, is that they be spiritually guided in the right direction. Often people say, "Well, I choose their school, but I let them choose what church they want." Somebody needs to rethink where the priorities are. If we would choose a school for a child, why would we let him just be wide open as to what he does spiritually? The scriptures teach that we ought to train up a child in the way that he should go. It is a proverb. It's not a rule. It's not a law. It is a proverb, which means that it is most generally true. The promise is that in his old age he'll not depart from it. When we pray for a son or for a daughter, we ought to promise God, "I will do all I can to ensure that this child is reared properly, trained properly, instructed spiritually, and pointed toward you and toward heaven. For I see no reason to live that's greater than to point the next generation toward the Lord Jesus Christ and to his kingdom and to eternity." What's a mother to do? Teach those children. Teach them respect. Teach them from the beginning to respect. There is a loss in our society today of people who really respect. There are a few of our young people who have been trained in their homes that they ought to respect their elders. Many have not been trained they ought to respect their parents even. The way they treat their parents is shameful, except that it ought to be expected in light of the small amount of time and instruction that they receive. Of the laws that God gave to the Jews in the Ten Commandments, there are 10. The verse 4 deal with man's relationship to God. The last 6 deal with man's relationship to other people. And he chose to make the very first one of those, the 5th of all the commands, is to children, obey your parents, for this is right. Obey your parents that your days upon the earth may be long. That's iterated by the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4, encouraging parents, bring up your children in the Lord. And children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. This is the first promise given with the first law, given with promise. It is appropriate that our children be taught in the home to respect authority. Boy, that's missing in our society. To respect their teachers, policemen, other officials, to respect the office, to respect their elders and the elders, to respect God, but just to know what it is to respect. Show appreciation, not to fly in the face of anyone, but to treat everyone in the way that they ought to be treated. The Proverbs encourage that we respect our mother and that we not ever insult her, even in her old age. She ought always to be revered because of what she's done for us, the price that she has paid, that we could be who we are, what we are, and doing what we do. In the Proverbs, the worthy woman is described in chapter 31, and she is indeed a giving, caring, self-sacrificing individual who puts everybody else ahead of herself. And as the scripture says there, who can find such a person? The idea is they are rare. They are rare and they are wonderful. And it concludes with the fact that her children rise up and they call her blessed. Her children come to understand. They respect her. They honor her. It's appropriate they should. But her husband, it adds, also honors her. And he says that there are many fine women that have come into the world, if I paraphrase slightly. There are many, but you surpass them all. Husbands, your wife who's brought your children into the world or who will bring your children into the world should be highly respected by you. You should see her as the apple of your eye in every way and every day that you live. And your little boys will never learn how to treat a woman unless you treat their mother with respect. And your little girls will never know what to really look for in a husband unless they see you treat their mother as a husband ought to treat his wife. If she someday makes a bad choice and you hadn't set the right example, you don't want to go there. You see, he says, beauty is vain. He says it matters who you are. Good men appreciate good women. And you must never take them for granted. Don't assume they'll always do that. Her husband also, he honors. Mothers should be honored every day. Not one day a year. They should be called often. They should be bought flowers. They should receive cards. My mama always liked to take her out to eat. We'd like to go down on Friday nights. And when I go to the hometown on Friday nights, still I drive by the place where we'd go, and she always wanted catfish. We'd say, what do you want, mama? And she'd say, oh, I don't know, but I knew. She wanted catfish. Those things you can't do more now than recall. So often I want to do it again. Do it while you can. Daddy, husband, children. For mother's impression that they make upon us is eternal. But their lives on this earth are not. And we must honor them while they live. Mothers, teach them to respect you and require it. Mothers, discipline your children from the beginning. Discipline's unpopular in today's world. But if we read the book of Proverbs over and over again, it makes it clear that if our children go wrong without having had proper instruction, we share whatever guilt that's involved. Neglecting them is guilt on our part. We must spend some time with them. We must give them the proper instruction. It is always best for them to have discipline. Children who are never disciplined will never know how to discipline themselves. If you let them do whatever they want to do, allow them to be wild and unruly and disrespectful, they will believe that that kind of behavior is acceptable in society, and they'll go out and do a lot of the things that you see kids on the news who've done. You don't want your kids on the news. You don't want to see their hands and not their face. Let them learn to keep some rules at home. Let them learn what discipline is. Teach them so that they can learn to discipline themselves, knowing the difference in right and wrong, to have the maturity to choose to do the right thing. That's what a mother is trying to do. The kids, you know that if you face those situations and you ask mom, what should I do? That mom will always say, do the right thing. And mom's telling you right. Do what's right. It will never hurt you. But what is wrong will almost always hurt you. It'll either hurt you physically, it'll hurt you spiritually, but there's a good chance that it may hurt you eternally. So to ensure these good things, mothers need to spend time with their children. I don't know how we got where we are in this society. I don't know how the bubble ran over us and snowballed on us and the world started to control and cause us to feel that we have to have everything that everybody else has. That we had to live at a level that's beyond what one income could provide. I don't know where those priorities ever happened. They weren't always the case. When the scripture says train a child in the way he should go, that's not just a matter of show him. The training process, the use of that word is like when you go to rehab. Whenever you have broken your foot or you've even had an amputation and then you have to learn to walk again. You have rehab and the trainer trains you what to do and how to walk and where to place your foot and where the weight should go. And it's just a day-by-day process. They do great things. I've got a plate and 5 screws in my right ankle and titanium hip. I've been through rehab. It takes time, step by step. The word train in that case means do that. Step by step, day by day, over and over and over again, train in such a way that the person has the right instructions and forms the right habits to walk in the right way and do the right thing. When you train him like that is when the scripture says he's not likely to depart from it in his old age. A bunch of billboards and signs and mimics may not do it, but the training process is what does it. But the training process takes time. It takes presence. It takes deliberation. And it may take away some of the fun things that people like to do. And it may take away from some of the group activities because we do it together in our home. What's a mother to do? You protect your family for the present in every way you can. But in the present, you protect them for the future, because you build into them and instill in them the tools that they will need, not only to live right, and do well, but they're learning how to be a mother. They're learning, Dad, how to be a dad by what they see in our home. What's a mother to do? Pray for those children before they come. Pray for them every day. Teach them respect. Spend time with them. And then pray some more. They will be wise enough to do the right thing. And then the one who's kept the rules, the scripture says, will be a joy to his parents. And that's what we want to be. Because we've got one great spiritual parent, our Father in heaven, whom we want to smile when he thinks of how we've lived and what we've done. As Abraham Lincoln said, I owe all that I am, all that I ever will be, to my mother. You see, this preacher has preached these many years because his mother was Christian. His dad was not. I thank God for my mother and for yours and for you, because life depends. Do all you can, the best you can, and pray for God's help and intervention where we are limited. If you're here today and you're subject to the invitation of the Lord anyway, we're going to sing a song of encouragement. You may be a child of a mother who's prayed for you for many, many years, that you'd repent of sin, straighten your life, that you would obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, you'd become a Christian. You may be one who's never obeyed the gospel. You've never been baptized, though your mom has taught you, and your teachers, and your dad, and all the rest of us have tried to teach you, and yet you have not yet done that. What could you do better to honor a mother today than to honor the Lord Jesus Christ, who died so you could be saved? What better? What do you need more than to become a child of God? Have your sins forgiven. You may be one who did one time obey the truth, and you floated away. You lost it somewhere along the way. You're not living like your mother taught you. You're not living like the Lord teaches. What better way could you honor all that effort and love your mom has expressed than to respond to the love of God as he's willing to forgive you if you repent? Come home. Mom anxiously waits. She leans. Perhaps already at heaven's window, maybe at heaven's gate. Better to get to see you do it here. You're subject to his call in any way. He invites you to come right now while we stand.